The Loss of the Ss Titanic by Lawrence Beesley, scholar of Gonville and Caius College, and one of the survivors. Narrated by Michael Scott. Produced by ThoughtAudio.com. I had been fortunate enough to secure a two-berth cabin to myself, D-56, quite close to the saloon, and most convenient in every way for getting about the ship. And on a big ship like the Titanic, it was quite a consideration to be on D-deck, only three decks below the top, or boat deck. Below D again were cabins on E and F decks, and to walk down from a cabin on F up to the top deck, climbing five flights of stairs on the way, was certainly a considerable task for those not able to take much exercise. The Titanic management has been criticized, among other things, for supplying the boat with lifts. It has been said they were an expensive luxury, and the room they took up might have been utilized in some way for more life-saving appliances. Whatever else may have been superfluous, lifts certainly were not. Old ladies, for example, in cabins on F deck, would hardly have got to the top deck during the whole voyage had they not been able to ring for the lift boy. Perhaps nothing gave one greater impression of the size of the ship than to take the lift from the top and drop slowly down past the different floors, discharging and taking in passengers just as in a large hotel. I wonder where the lift boy was that night. I would have been glad to find him in our boat, or in the Carpathia when we took count of the saved. He was quite young, not more than 16, I think. A bright-eyed, handsome boy with a love for the sea and the games on deck and the view over the ocean. And he did not get any of them. One day, as he put me out of the lift and saw through the vestibule windows, a game of deck cuots in progress, he said, in a wistful tone, "My, I wish I could go out there sometimes." I wished he could too, and made a jesting offer to take charge of his lift for an hour while he went out to watch the game. But he smilingly shook his head and dropped down in answer to an imperative ring from below. I think he was not on duty with his lift after the collision, but if he were, he would smile at his passengers all the time as he took them up to the boats waiting to leave the sinking ship. After undressing and climbing into the top berth, I read from about 11:15 to the time we struck, about 11:45. During this time, I noticed particularly the increased vibration of the ship, and I assumed that we were going at higher speed than at any other time since we sailed from Queenstown.